So Satya from Nagasuma's lab will give us a demo about transcriptome analysis.
No, I'm not. Okay, good evening, people. So I will be giving a demo for transcriptome analysis using R, like mainly analyzing microarray data using R and network analysis using Cytoskip. Ma'am has already defined about the properties, different network properties, and then distribution, like power law distribution and all those things, but I'll be giving the demo like how to analyze and how to get those information actually. So to start with, this is the overview of the talk, whatever I'm going to talk. So what are the databases available for retrieving transcriptome data, not necessarily transcriptome data, any kind of functional data in that case. And then I'll be taking this data set for running the demo, like for using R. So this one, what they have done is they have taken the macrophages. I think everybody knows what is macrophage. I assume that everybody knows macrophage. Macrophage is an immune cell type that plays an important role in innate as well as adaptive immune system. So what generally happens is when a pathogen interacts with the host, like the first and foremost contact is like these macrophages, these kind of macrophage is the primary immune cell type that comes in contact. These are antigen presenting cells. So I'll be describing about it in detail in next slide. So, and then the next step is data pre-processing. Once, if we get the data sets, like different, the expression data, what are the process we need to do? Essentially background correction, normalization, and summarization. So there are different methods available for background correction and normalization. I'll be explaining about it and then showing how to do it. And then once the pre-processing is done, next we need to map the probes to the genes in order to account it, which gene is essentially changing, whether it is upregulated or downregulated, and all those information. And then, differential analysis, there are different statistical tests to say whether the given set of gene is differentially regulated in comparison to the control set. So differential analysis is very, very, it's individual dependent, like whether you wanted to analyze the time series data. So in that case, across different time points, what are the genes which are differentially, genes which are like varying, that will be of our interest. So in case of disease versus control, what are the gene sets are like which are varying in comparison to the disease sets? So coming to the databases for retrieving microarray data, Array Express and GEO, Gene Expression Omnibus, are the most commonly used databases. So not just the microarray data, you can get different kind of functional genomics data as well, like RNA-seq data, miRNA, mid-nome data, then methylation data and all those things. So this is the recent, it has around 61,540 experiments that includes microarray and sequencing, high throughput sequencing data. And like there are around 18,51,756 assays. So like 38 TB of archive data. So the thing is, it's not just like someone was asking whether microarray will be like obsolete kind of thing. So it's not exactly that way. Like people are still generating microarray data. There is some utility, like it has some advantage over RNA-seq also. So people are interested, like they can look into these databases to get the gene expression data, like microarray data or any kind of functional genomics data. And this one, the Cancer Genome Atlas, TCGA, this is very, very specific. Like you get like different kind of high throughput data. Like there are like 11 different types of high throughput data. It starts from clinical information of the patient, image information, then a transcriptome, RNA sequencing, miRNA sequencing and all those information. So if you're working on cancers, then you can look into this database. So it has information for 34 different cancer types belonging to like broad class of carcinoma, sarcoma, leukoma, and all, everything actually. So that's about this. So coming to the, since everybody uses GEO, I have just put the GEO webpage to show how exactly we can search for our area of like if it is cancer or whatever you are interested, how to get the gene expression data for the specific area. So there is a search tab, so you can type whatever you want, like macrophage. Since I wanted to show a demo on macrophages infected with Staphylococcus aureus, specific to Homo sapiens, that's a keyword I have used. So there is a display settings, so this is like general information. So in a, whichever way, like you can arrange the, sort the series based upon the number of samples or tissue type and all those information. So here, if you come, you could see like platform, series, samples, and all those information. So this is something which will be of use. So there are like different way, different types of gene, like micro, like array types through which you can study the transcriptome information. So most commonly used are Affymetrix, Agilent, and Illumina. There are other kinds also. So if you are specifically searching for Affymetrix data, each array has its own specificities. So one is better than other in some way or other. So series refers to like, I will define what a series also, and the number of samples it has. So for a given query, like I've got around like two data sets, two series and 45 samples belonging to one particular sample. So I should explain what is series, what is samples, and what is platform in the next slide. So this is an overall data organization of like GEO. Like you have the platform, you have the samples, and you have the series. And this will be available for every data that is available in the database. But this one, the data set and the profiles will be available only if the data is curated by the GEO curators. So to platform will have information about what kind of array they have used, what kind of sequencing, like sequencer they have used. That information will be provided by the platform. So the main thing is the transcriptome coverage varies between the platform. In case of Affymetrix, like there are like different kind of platforms like GPL570, GPL96. Among all the things, GPL570 has a maximum coverage. It has around 54,000 probe sets. So like all those information will be present in the platform. And the samples, to define samples, say for example, you are taking to get the sample information, whether it is disease specific sample or control specific, or either like the particular patient has undergone any treatment or any kind of perturbation, all those information will be present in the samples. In case of series, it is set of samples which are like most of the time performed by the single group and trying to address one particular problem. So the data set is a curated version of a series. So you get, people like the GEO curators will check whether the particular series has what biologically and statistically relevant number of samples. That is one thing, and other kind of filters also they have. So the profile is, if the particular series has a data set, then you can go for the profile addressing also, like how the expression profile of one gene varies across a multiple samples that is considered in that series. So this is about the definition, like description of the array or sequencer. Samples describes the condition under which an individual was handled, the manipulation it underwent, and the abundance of measurement of each element derived from it. So the samples can be technical replicates, like you can have technical as well as biological replicates. Technical replicates are like same sample, like run it multiple, you will be running for multiple times, mainly to account the technical biases. Whereas biological replicates are like, for the same disease, you will be taking the samples from the same organism, trying to address for the same disease, something of that sort. Biological replicates are mainly considered to address the heterogeneity among the patients or heterogeneity among the cell lines which you are considering. So series are like group of related samples and provides a focal point and description of the whole study. Yeah. So it has set of samples trying to address a particular study and most of the time done by a particular group, specific group. So it's a curated version of series data set, and the profiles, so expression measurement for an individual gene across all the samples in a data set. So coming to the file formats, if you go to GEO, you can get two different kinds of files. One is raw files, another one is two different kinds of files. One is raw files, another one is processed files. So in case of Affymetrix, it is cell file. So the cell file will have like the number of pixels, like probe information, and the number of grids they have used to account the intensity and all those things. Text files is for agilent similarly, and SRA, like sequence read archive, is for RNA-seq. And the processed files, like people, so soft matrix, series matrix files, and soft formatted family files. So these are like, this will have, if the person is doing some kind of experiment, obviously they might have done the normalization, and they might have published also. So what kind of, the normalized data and all those information will be put up in the processed files. So when do we go for raw files and when do we go for processed files? If you're trying to address, like if I want to study macrophage expression profile in different series, I can't take the processed file there. So I need to like take the raw files, because if I take the processed file, one person might have done quantile normalization. Other person might have done percentile normalization. I should have a common scale to compare it. So in that case, I need to go for the raw files, take the cell files or the text files, and then normalize it so that it is comparable, even though it is from different group. So this is the example set I'm going to discuss now. So this one, they have taken the macrophages and they have exposed to Staphylococcus aureus, and then at different time points, and they wanted to address what are the changes happening at the transcriptome level. So if you see, like I have already explained, macrophages are like important immune cell types, which are like, which act as a like antigen presenting cells, and most of the time this is the one, depending upon the type of the stimuli that macrophage expose, so it will be like either pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory. So the downstream immune cell types will detect that and act accordingly. So in this case, they have mentioned something like there may be some kind of cytoprotective mechanism by changing the expression profiles inside the macrophages, which is most of the time you get to observe when Mycobacterium tuberculosis gets into the latent phase of the thing. So that's what they have done it. So describing about the data. So what are the essential thing which you need if you want to go for the transcriptome data? So the first and foremost thing is like, you need to know what is that sample is about. Whether it is a control data, whether it is a disease sample, whether it is a treated sample, whether it is a time series data, and all those things. So according to me, like I use ArrayExpress extensively, more frequently than GEO. So in ArrayExpress, you get something called SDRF files. There you get clear definition, what is the sample, like whether it's from a patient sample or it's a cell line data, or the age, gender, and all those information will also be like given. Because most of the time when we do the analysis, there will be like, in addition to the actual signal, there may be like some other like additional like signal because of the other factors which we are not really interested. Maybe like they call that as batch effects, maybe experimental errors, date specific. If you perform one set of array today and another for the same condition, if you perform the same experiment the next day, so there will be like difference. After processing, if you cluster the data, those two things will be like clustered separately. So to account all those things, you need maximum metadata as possible. So, but to perform the differential analysis, this is the basic one you need. So here we have around 30 samples, and this is about the conditions describing about it. So the first, like I have, like they have given data for like 8 hour, 24 hour, and 48 hour, and they have 5 different biological replicates, and every sample has its specific controls, so it is easy to address in this case. So whatever data we have considered is a Affymetrix data. So the pre-processing steps varies between the type of the platform we use. So in case of Affymetrix, like the mRNA target sequence, say you have the reference sequence, reference transcriptome data. So you need to design a probe. Generally, the probes are like complementary to your reference sequence. So these are generally like 25 base pairs in length. And then in case of affymetrix, you have two different kinds. One is perfect match, another one is mismatch. So perfect match is used to account the signal, and mismatch is used to account the noise, non-specific binding. So perfect match and mismatch, the same sequence except at the 13th position. This is just to say like how much the probe is specific and how much signal is contributed when the probe is not specific. So you will have, so for every gene, there will be like 20 to 25 probe sets, and there will be like two probes, like one a mismatch and one perfect match probe. So this is the array, and then you prepare your sample, load it, allow it for hybridization, and then you get the image, and then from the image, you derive the cell file. So this is about the description. I think I have explained about it. So each gene or portion of a gene is represented by 1 to 20 oligonucleotides, the probes, which are like generally 25 base pairs in length. The oligonucleotide is generally called a probe. Perfect match is exact complementary to the reference sequence, whereas mismatch, at the 13th position, there will be a variation. So the probe pair, like for every gene, there will be like 20 to 25 probe pair. So the probe pair includes PM and MM, that is perfect match and mismatch. So in the second, So every probe pair will have a affymetrix ID generally. So when you get the array, the expression data captured from the imaging after hybridization, it is just your affymetrix probe ID, and then the expression values derived, and how much of pixels they have used for getting the foreground information, and how much of pixels they have used for the total signal. The total is foreground plus background. The foreground is the actual signal, and the background is the noise. So you get all these files, DAT file, cell file, and CDF file. Cell file is very important for the analysis, and CDF file will have the probe and the corresponding gene sequence and the gene for, like, it codes for. So if you have the probe sequence, then obviously it is complementary to the particular gene. So you will be trying to account the expression profile of that particular gene. So the corresponding gene information will also be there. So I'll be using R. This is the link for downloading R. And then if you want to, like, R is the... R is the basic thing you need, and then RStudio you need to install. If you are comfortable with R, you can use R only. And then if you want to, there are specific packages for analyzing microarray data. So to install those packages, this is the like source, give the location of the wherever the package is available, and give the biosylite, and the package name will, you can install it actually. So these are the basic packages. There are like few packages which comes when you install R only, like these are like inbuilt packages. And these are the ones which you need to install to analyze microarray data. These are the basic ones. So Affy, because I'm using affymetrix data, if it is Agilent, there are specific packages. Gene filter, one more thing is when you studying, when you get the gene expression data, so you need to account whether the particular probe is expressed in the cell type or in the patient. So you get the tag like the probe is absent or present. This is generally calculated based upon the expression level. They have a particular threshold. If the overall expression of that particular gene, if it is expressed above that, then only they will say that as a, label it as a present. Otherwise, they like consider that one as a absent. So those are in general absent in controls as well as diseased set. So annotation is to do the annotation, like if you don't, if you just have the probe information, and if you want to get the gene information for which, like what is the corresponding gene, the probe is like complementary to. So that information, if you want, you can go with like install annotate. And there are like, as we know, like once we get the list of differentially expressed genes, we need to do some kind of annotation. Which pathways are like what are the pathways which are regulated by these upregulated or downregulated set of genes. And then for that, you can use a KEG database. And then GeoStats is also available. You can make note of it. I didn't put it here. And then gene plotter for plotting like PCA, heat map, and all those things can be generated using gene plotter and gplots. So yeah, I'll go to the demo part. So these are the, I've already run it and I've generated the results. If it takes some time, we can just go with whatever data I have, like the images I have. So these are the basic packages. If everybody knows R, then it will not be like so difficult. I'll just run through the, okay, fine. So first thing is you need to set the directory where exactly the files are located, I mean the cell files and the phenodata information. So two main things which we need is the cell files, which has the expression information for different conditions, and the phenodata, like what is the sample corresponds to, whether it is control or disease, and all those information. So this is the place where my data is located. So if I list the files, so there are additional files. Now we need to check only the cell files because we need to use the cell files alone. So there is a command in R which can read the cell files. So that is read afi. It will take a few minutes. So this is about the cell files which I have read. So this has around whatever data I've used is affymetric specific, and the number of grids that is present in each array is 1164 into 1164. So each feature has these many, each spots has these many stuff. And then I've already run the normalization thing. So if you could see here. So there are different kinds of normalization. One is normalization methods they use for affymetrics. The most commonly used are GCRMA, RMA, and MAS5. So what they do is, so you have a perfect match, mismatch, and this is your reference. So in case of MAS5, it uses both the information to account the PM is used to calculate the signal, and MM is used to calculate the noise. So they account it based upon it, but the problem is one gene can have multiple probes. For each probe only will be present in multiple numbers. So they use just the averaging. So PM minus MM for every probe, and then just average thing. Do the averaging of calculate the mean of the PM minus MM value. But the problem here is it is not very efficient in addressing the noise, because MM calculates in addition to the noise, MM accounts for the signal also. So it is not a very efficient method, but when the affymetrics platform was given, this is the inbuilt normalization method people were using. But currently what people are using is GCRMA. So RMA is something like, It doesn't even use the MM. It just accounts whatever value that calculates, like PM accounts, that will be considered as a signal information. Whereas GCRMA, it considers both PM and MM, but in case of MM, like depending upon like which bases are accounting for higher noises, they have come up with a mixture model that like that says how like which kind of like what kind of the presence of which specific base pairs causes more noise and which are the ones which causes least noise in a different sample, in a large pool of sample. So compared to these two methods, GCRMA is found to be better because it uses both PM as well as MM and try to account it. So here, so I've used GCRMA in this part. So if you see the type is, you can go to the help menu and then type whichever function which you want to look. So GCRMA is a function to normalize the data, do the background correction as well as normalization. If you see the type, you can give like full model affinities, just the MM or just the PM. So have you have given the full model which accounts, which uses both MM as well as PM. So I've done the normalization before only, so I'm just showing the data now. Data norm. GCRMA. So this is the normalized data. If I want to get the matrix out of it, so express is a one. And then so I have the normal data which is not normalized as well as the data which is normalized. So this is how the box plot looks for the normalized and this is before normalization, this is after normalization. And this is like median centering. So before even going for like, this is a prerequisite for doing, performing the differential analysis. So we need to account the variability in the samples. So we need to perform the normalization. If you see the median values of these samples, it's like exactly almost. Yeah, in order to identify the probes which are like absent based upon the expression values, if it is absent in more than, I've already mentioned, like the, it should have a value above the particular threshold value. So there are packages which has defined like what kind of threshold for a given set of samples you can define. And then if the particular gene is like less than that threshold in more than 90% of the samples, you don't even need to consider that gene for your further analysis. That is what PANP package helps in doing. So this particular part helps, so you perform that analysis. So after performing filtering, gene filtering, the dimension of, initially the dimension of the data is, so this is 5 × 30. Now it is, after filtering, this process is like after filtering. So it is 23,370. So most of the genes were like less than the threshold in most of the samples. Once you are done with the gene filtering process, we need to map the probe. So whatever data I have, okay. So if you see, this is the row name. So you have a probe ID. Eight. right? And you have condition 1, condition 2, up to condition 30. So now you have at the level of probe to at different conditions. Now you need to map these probes to the gene level. So one gene can have multiple probes, and there are conditions where like multiple probes corresponding to the same gene. So that means it's not very specific, that particular probe. You need to remove all those probe sets, as well as next process is you need to map it to the particular gene. So if I say for this one only, probe 2 also maps to this, probe 3 also maps to this. So you either you can take the mean or median or whatever you want to do it, but median is generally better. And then this will become gene 1. So you will have gene 2 condition mapping, then you need to go for the differential analysis. So like for getting probe to gene information, like which are the probes corresponding to the particular gene, the CDF file can be utilized. There you can get probes and the gene list, like the corresponding gene list. So I have used that information and then performed the probe to gene mapping. So after probe to gene mapping, these are the steps which involves for mapping probes to genes. So this is how the data looks after mapping to the probes. Dem of final pre-processed data. Normalized data. So we had around like how many? 23,000 probes and 30 conditions. After mapping to the genes, it is around 12,021 genes. So this has both coding as well as non-coding. If you really want to work only on the coding sets, you can remove the non-coding genes. So now we need to get the pheno data. Head of pheno data. So this is how the pheno data looks. So every sample you have considered, the cell file name and the corresponding condition. What is the whatever the pheno phenotype information. So now we have the data. So you have the gene information and the condition. Now some set of conditions are control and some are diseased. And if you wanted to see the differential regulation, you need to here in this case, you have data at 8-hour, 24-hour, and 48-hour, everything and 5 samples in each set. And everything has a time point specific controls. So you will have 5 controls everywhere, specific controls. So you need to get the differential analysis. So disease 1 at 8-hour minus control 1 at 8-hour. So similarly, you do for like you need to get the data, do the contrast matrix, generate a contrast matrix which like contains these information. Yeah, so after normalization, so this one, this data, if you see the gene expression, the heat map of the expression profile, this is how it looks. You can see 2 major clusters, and all these things are the control set and these are the disease set. So, and even within the cluster, it is very, very specific, like a 24-hour, 8-hour, 24-hour and 48-hour. So it is like there is not much of outliers in the data. So it is very clear actually. finding such data, if you're going to GEO and fetching the data from the GEO, finding this kind of data is very, very difficult. You need the FeNO data, so you need to assign which belongs to the disease set and which belongs to the control set. End of. So you know from here, which are the disease and which are the control. So you need to make your contrast matrix in such a way that you get the final data fitted. Here, we don't have any technical replicates, so we cannot actually fit at this level. If you have a technical replicates, you need to patient one and sample one and sample two are belonging to the same patient and perform multiple times. That kind of thing means you can fit at this level and then do the differential analysis. But you have a specific control, so you can perform the differential analysis and fit at the later level. So this is for creating the contrast matrix, control disease minus control. So this is how the contrast matrix looks. Head of. So if you have a label D1 minus C1, so you have D3 and all, C2, C3 and all. The matrix will be D1 minus 1, 0. So whatever data it comes, it creates in such. I think ma'am has explained about the conceptual part of this, so it's just the demo which I think. If you have any doubts, just. So dim of contrast matrix, after performing the differential analysis, contrast matrix. So you have 30 samples, which includes 15 controls and 15 disease. So after performing differential analysis, just the 15 total, control one minus, so you will have 5 in this case, 5 in this case, and 5 in this case, after performing disease minus control in every set. And then you can fit the data. So now you have 5 biological replicates capturing the fold change only. So similarly for this condition and this condition. If you want to fit the data and perform some statistical analysis, then you can proceed with that. So here we have used a function called ebase to perform t statistics. So here it's just the 2 samples which we wanted to compare it. So ebase have you can perform f test as well as t test and other ANOVA and f test as I mentioned. So if you want to do some statistical inference, there are specific packages, but ebase is the most commonly used. So we have used it here. So this is so finally we have only technically speaking, we have just 3 conditions and we wanted to see how the expression profile varies in each condition. But if you see, we have 5 biological, the final fold change data only, 5 samples here, 5 samples here, and 5 samples here. So after fitting the data, it will be just 3. One from this, one from this, and one from this. So looking into that, to fit the data and identify the most differentially regulated genes only, we need either we need to go for t-test or f-test. If we want to see what are the most varying set of genes across different time points, f-test will be better, I guess, in that case. But here we just wanted to see, with respect to the control, what are the genes which like how many genes are like which are the genes which are like differentially regulated, upregulated or downregulated. So in that case, t-test will be better. There are like better statistical packages which you can look into, but these are like basic ones. So the final fitted data that like even the biological replicates corresponding to 8 hour, like 24 hour and 48 hour looks like this. And this is the dimension of that data coefficients. So you have three different columns corresponding to different conditions. So these are the fold change expression level changes for different conditions as such. At 24 hour, what is the expression value of the gene 1, that is ZZZ3? So it is like minus 1 point something, like one fold down, two fold. Actually, this is in the log scale, log to scale. So when you say it in the absolute thing, then it is two fold down regulated. So correspondingly, you can see the overall expression profile. But now we need to put a statistical filter, say identify, fetch the genes which are like one fold or two fold upregulated or downregulated. So it should be statistically significant also. So we can put a p-value cutoff also, like p-value less than 0.05 or adjusted p-value less than 0.05. So when I perform that analysis, so that's what I'm doing it here, like output DEGs, like find out all the DEGs, the expression of all the genes that is present in that particular condition. And then first I'm putting the p-value cutoff, like that is less than 0.05 or equal to 0.05. And then for that subset, I'm putting the log fold change cutoff of 2, like that is 1. In the log scale, it is 1, but in the normal scale, the power value, it is 2. So if you see the final output for 48 hour, so output final. These are the list of genes which are like significantly regulated at 8 hour, like fold change also more than 1 and with a statistically significant p-value. So if you see the heat map of this one, it's all dark, I don't know why. But in general, it was like more on the down-regulated side. So this is the 8 hour and this is 24 and 48 hour. So the compared to like 8 hour, the expression profile of 48 hour and 24 hour like very similar. So once if we after getting the list of genes, we can either go for enrichment analysis like GWO enrichment or pathway enrichment analysis. There are a lot of online tools like WebGestol, David, and other things. So I'll be doing that. So this is the list of genes which are differentially regulated, statistically differentially regulated. at 8-hour time point when macrophage is exposed to Staphylococcus aureus, you can get the log fold change value. The overall average expression is expression of that particular gene across all the arrays, whatever 30 arrays they have considered. And the moderated T value, that one, P value and the adjusted P value. Here for the adjusted P value, is done to account the FDR correction, false discovery rate, using BH, Benjamin Hochberg method. So this is the final output you get when you do the analysis. But what will you do after this is the question. So you can either go to take this list of genes and go to methods like WebGestol. This is a very good one. So either you can go for gene ontology terms. Gene ontology terms includes biological process, molecular function, and the cellular component. Whatever genes we have given, in which category it belongs, whether it is present in case of cellular component, whether all those genes are present in the cytosol or mitochondrial membrane, or all this information you can get it. In case of biological process, what are the binding and all those things like? Whether it is involved in transport and stuff. Yeah, for the same thing I've done for the molecular process and stuff. It's an overall annotation, like almost all the genes, like 1200 genes belong to all the categories. But if you go to the specific function, like gene enrichment term, you get the enrichment score. So it is based upon like number of genes in your list by the total number of genes associated to that particular category. And you get the p-value and other statistical significant measure for that also. So based on that also, you can account it. Like these are like general categories. If you check for the pathways, you get molecular, like metabolic processes, signaling pathways. So those kind of things won't be like very important. If you get something like innate immune response, in this case, macrophages treated with SRDS, something related to immune signaling if you get, or some like basic cellular processes like cell cycle regulation or something of that sort, then it will be very significant. So you need to, like, depending upon your objective or overall changes also, you can look into it when you are doing enrichment analysis. So this is the GWAS analysis. Benjamin Hochberg is the commonly used method, so, and found to be better also. So this is the online thing. You can get the pathways which are also enriched for a given set of genes. Yeah, this is the hierarchical layout which you get. So this is for the biological process, and you get for the molecular function and for the cellular component also. Rather than looking at the top level in the hierarchy, if you go to the bottom thing, then it will be very, very specific, and then you can account it. In this case, it's more on the cell cycle regulation, transcriptional regulation, the basal the processes are like getting regulated. That is what they have reported in the paper also. So WebGestol can also be used in addition to, like, David is also commonly used gene enrichment methodology. Panther is also one of the things. And then coming to the protein-protein, the next part, I will be like giving a demo on Cytoscape. Before that, so the most commonly used databases for getting protein-protein interaction are like string. So string has both predicted as well as experimentally determined. And other things are like intact, then biogrid, signaling can also be used. Like signaling has information for the transcriptional regulation, like transcription factor to the target gene information also. And there are other databases also. Like in our lab, we have curated the network, protein-protein interaction network, that has around how many nodes? I've like, it's more than 20, like at least around 9,000 nodes and more interactions as such. Those interactions are given based upon the confidence score they have derived from the string. So you can look into string also. Okay, it's for the given whatever list of genes I've identified as a differentially regulated list. So for those genes from the whatever network we have curated, we have retrieved what are the genes which are interacting with these gene lists. So that network I'm using for showing the demo, like for Cytoscape demo. So I have around some 1,400 genes. So what are the other genes which are involved in interaction that will be taken for? So in Cytoscape, you can load two different kinds of thing. One is network as such. So you need to have a like three different columns or like two columns, like which is the source node, which is the target node. And if you know like how much is the interaction efficiency, like A is regulating, like upregulating B, how much as such, like quantitatively how much, like higher or lower, or the edge the strength of the edge can also be given. Another one is the network attribute file, whether the given list of nodes, whether it is upregulated, downregulated. So those things will help us in visualizing the data, the network attribute file. So import the network file, import. This is source node and this is the target thing, target node. Okay. So you can visualize the network in different layout. So go to view layout. So generally people use force directed perfuse. Force-directed layout. I think it's a default thing. So either you can use circular layout or whatever. So this is whatever interactions which we got is like transcription factor and the target gene interaction. That's why it is looking like that. It's not the entire PPI network. So we have collected around, like, for 1,500 curated transcription factors, we have identified the list of target genes through like checking with ChIP-seq data and other things. So we have around 24,000 interactions. So from that, when we fetch the interaction specific to those 741 nodes. So we have 741 nodes in this network and 1,416 edges, the interactions in this. So in case of transcription factor, like transcriptional regulatory network, going with hierarchical layout will be much better. So you can see like which layers, what are the different transcription factors regulating target genes at different layers. So this is about the thing. So ma'am was talking about in-degree, out-degree and all those network properties. So there is a tool in Cytoscape called network analyzer. So you can analyze your network through that. Either you can consider the network as directed or undirected, but it affects only at the level of degree, like in-degree and out-degree. Otherwise, most of the things will be similar. So this is about the overall, like, what is the clustering coefficient and what is the network diameter of the given network. So this is a subset of network. If you, like, you can check whether this follows a power law distribution or not. It's just a subset. This is not the entire network. So this is not following power law. So this is the smaller module in the network. So you can't, check whether it follows a power law distribution. And then a number of nodes and all these information you can have, like in-degree distribution, like what is the maximum number of, in-degree is the number of edges that is coming to the particular node. Out-degree is like number of edges that is going from a particular node. So most of the nodes in the network has an in-degree distribution of one. So, and there are very few nodes which has like in degree of like 7, like in the higher order. I think it will be like exactly opposite in case of out degree distribution. So since it is a transcription factor target gene, it's a regulatory network, the most of the nodes as like found to have a shortest path of one. It's a direct regulation. So there are like hardly 200 of such nodes have shortest path of two. So if we consider the entire network and perform in our lab, whatever analysis we do, we consider the entire protein-protein interaction network, incorporate the gene expression data into it, perform the shortest path analysis, and then identify the topmost paths, and then come for the network. This is just for the demo, so we thought we'll take a smaller module, which is a subset of the bigger network, and then do the analysis. This is just for the demo thing, and you cannot infer anything like solid inference, you cannot. So these are all the basic information which you can get from the network properties, which you can get from the network analysis plugin. So if you want to check what are the enrichment, like we went to WebGestol and checked for the, like what are the gene ontologies or the pathways that are enriched for the particular module. You can use Bingo also, that's a plugin in Cytoscape to identify the most enriched modules. So before, so if we have a bigger network, if we want to identify the clicks within the network based upon the clustering coefficient, you can use algorithm like M-code and things to get the clusters, different clusters, the clustering algorithms. So this one is also something of that sort, J-active modules. So yeah, I didn't load the import attribute file. So this is node attribute file. So node attribute file has list of gene that is present in my network, the log fold change value, how much is the differential regulation, and whether it is upregulated or downregulated. So all these information you can give so that you can visualize your network in a better way. Select. So you can color your nodes based upon the expression preference. This is like whether it is in a particular network, whether the nodes are upregulated, downregulated. You can give the color coding for that. So that information can be taken from the network attribute file. So here, if you select like based upon the fold change, exp, okay. So it can be like discrete mapping. Down can be given. So this is about it. So these are like different color coding that you can do. And then the shape of the size of the node also you can give based upon the expression profile. So log node. So the downregulated will have the smaller size and the upregulated will have the maximum size which you are giving. So I'm not changing much here. So like if you have varied changes, so if you have change in the network, like the fold change values are, I think, more or less in the same range. That's why the nodes are like not, the size of the node is, even after changing the size of the node, it is not clearly defined. So you can define the modules either based upon the expression value, the normalized expression value, or fold changes, or whether it is upregulated, downregulated, the discrete labels also. So using J-Active modules, I'm going to cluster the modules based upon the log fold change. So like if you see, the module one has the maximum number of nodes and the edges, whereas 2, 3, 4, 5 and all is like hardly one or two nodes in it and the edges. So if you have a bigger network and if you are incorporating the gene expression data into it, and if you know like these modules are known to like seem to be getting regulated, you can do network specific enrichment analysis. In that case, J-Active module, that plugin is very helpful. So this is the network which we have got, which is known to be like highly regulated based upon the expression data also. If you want to see what are the enrichments that are like, what are the processes it is involved in, can go to Bingo and then do the analysis. The same thing, whether you wanted to do the over-representation, which are the gene ontology terms which are overrepresented from the given list of genes, or whatever, like whether it is a biological process or whatever cellular component or molecular function, all these information can be, like, according to your thing, you can select it and then perform. Okay, I'll give biology. So, see, being audited. Like analysis, right? No, I can't. This is the one, right? I did. Yeah, here. But I didn't save the image. No, it worked just like that. Okay, fine, I'll get this one. What is that, bingo? I'll just show. So I performed some problems, so I'm not able to load it in my machine. I don't know what. So when you do the enrichment analysis, you'll get something of this sort. So the size and the color represents if it is more significant. Here, in case of protein binding, nucleotide binding, ribonucleotide binding, this is for something else. I'm just showing because it's a sample anyways. So this is about it. So higher the statistically significant it is, the grading, the color grading varies. So it starts from orange to the green thing. Yeah, that's about it. Yeah, it's done. If anybody have any doubts, you can ask.
So many data in databases available. We select particular one database. And we
one database in this sense?
Like NCBI database.
GEO, you cannot analyze every other data if you have a specific cancer or something.
And this particular approach we apply.
Yeah. The same approach can be. You can analyze the data, infer the differentially expressed genes. But most of the time, people generate their own data and then do it. Unless or until if you're interested in doing metadata analysis, like already people, see, if whatever data set I have taken, they have already published the paper. So no use in taking the same data and then working on it. If you're going to collate like multiple data sets, which is trying to address some of this, like what may be the factor which causes macrophage, like the dominant, like what to say, the latent characteristics for Staphylococcus aureus. If you can collect all the data and then do the analysis, then it will be better. Literature mining for? Okay. See, actually, if you go to GEO, in the advanced search only, you can do like tissue type and all those things. So.